Ivan, I am very honored to be presenting at your conference. I am Dr. Nikita Arora. I'm an ophthalmologist and a medical retina fellow. And the talk of my topic today is proliferative diabetic retinopathy in young. Are we creating enough awareness? So as we all know, a diabetic retinopathy encompasses a broad range of fundus manifestations and diabetes in diabetic mellitus patient, and it affects 1 in 3 patients with diabetes. Diabetic retinopathy and diabetic macular edema is the most common microvascular complication of diabetes mellitus, leading to visual loss in working adult population. In the Wisconsin Epidemiological Study of Diabetic Retinopathy cohort, after 20 years of diabetes mellitus, nearly 99% of type 1 diabetic and 60% with type 2 disease demonstrated some degree of DR. Proliferative diabetic retinopathy, that is PDR, was found to be 50% in type 1 patients who had 20 years duration of disease and 25% of type 2 patients who had 25 years of duration of disease. Since it is the foremost cause of preventable vision loss in working adults, early detection of retinopathy in DM patients is critical since the first stages are not very asymptomatic. So the risk factors of development of DR are as follows. Non-modifiable is the duration of diabetes, puberty, pregnancy. Modifiable is hyperglycemia, dyslipidemia, obesity, hypertension, smoking, anemia. And novel risk factors, that is apolipoproteins, inflammation, hormone, oxidative stress, vitamin D, and genetic factors. In pathophysiology, in diabetes, there is hypoglycemia, which leads to biochemical and molecular changes, which further leads to hypoxia, oxidative stress, inflammation, and there is a release of cytokines and chemokines, which leads to endothelial or pericyte loss of the blood vessel, thickening of basement membrane, and leukocytosis, which leads to macro or micro complications of diabetes. So I would just very briefly go over the clinical features, because since it is a diabetic conference, so these dot hemorrhages can either be microaneurysms, that is outpouchings from the vessels, or it can be dot hemorrhages. There are further more types of lesions seen on the fundus, that is the retinal picture, that is superficial flame-shaped hemorrhages and deep blot hemorrhages. There are exudates, that is, they are, they develop at the junction of normal and edematous retina. It is categorized into hard exudates, which are basically aggregation of lipids, and soft exudates, which is, nerve fiber ischemia. So, and other changes are venous changes on retina examination, which can either be seen as dilatation and tortuosity, or there is focal dilatation and there is focal narrowing. There can be looping, or there can be sausage-like segmentation. The next change is intraretinal microvascular abnormalities, which is nothing but arteriovenous shunts, which you can see, which are aggregated in this area. Coming to proliferative retinopathy, there is basically proliferation of new vessels, which can either be at the disc or it can be elsewhere. There also, it usually develops at the areas where there is no perfusion, at the junction where there is no perfusion and there is vascular perfusion. So these are all the new capillaries, the new blood vessels. Diabetic retinopathy can be classified into no apparent retinopathy, mild non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy, moderate NPDR, severe NPDR, and proliferative diabetic retinopathy. Coming to my case report, a 21-year-old presented to us with chief complaints of diminution of vision in right eye since 1 month. His best corrected visual acuity was 6/12 in the right eye and 6/6 part in the left eye. The patient was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes at the age of 11. When we inquired about his glycemic status, he said, "I am controlling my medication on my own and I am not taking any medicine." So we were a little surprised with the response that we got, because from that we came to know that the patient is not very sincere towards taking his medication. So on examination, anterior segment showed no abnormality in both the eyes. Intraocular pressures were within normal range. Conioscopy showed normal angle structures. Patient was dilated for detailed fundus examination. And in the meanwhile, we asked him if he knew that, diabetes does cause any changes on the retina or eye. So he was unaware of those changes. On fluorescein angiography, we can see that there are areas of hyperfluorescence which coincide with the neovascularization of disc and hyperfluorescence which coincide with the areas of capillary dropout areas. OCT, that is optical coherence tomography, showed a center involving diabetic macular edema in the right eye and non-center involving in the left eye. patient was sent for systemic examination and his blood sugars were very deranged. He was advised to undergo panretinal photocoagulation for both the eyes, followed by intravitreal injection in the right eye for diabetic macular edema. However, even after treatment, patient developed complications and was eventually taken up for surgery, that is pars plana vitrectomy. But even after surgery, at two-year follow-up, his vision in the right eye was 660 and in the left eye was 624. So coming to the discussion, type 1 diabetes mellitus is one of the most common childhood chronic diseases and its prevalence is increasing. Around 10% of all people with diabetes have type 1 diabetes. Diabetic retinopathy is the leading cause of visual impairment among type 1 as well as type 2 patients. Poor glycemic control is the modifiable risk factor, and intensive glycemic control has been shown to reduce the risk of progression to sight-threatening retinopathy. The age of onset of diabetes mellitus is considered an important factor in development and progression of DR, especially in type 1 patients, as the longer the age, the more are the changes. Also, during the time of puberty, these changes are seen to get aggravated. So until recently, children with diabetes were not being routinely included in screening programs for retinopathy. However, countries like UK and USA have started some screening programs. Although sight-threatening retinopathy is uncommon in childhood, the same does not apply to all changes of retinopathy. It is now well recognized that early changes of retinopathy can be seen in childhood and adolescence. Reported prevalence ranges from 10 to 42%. Prevalence of DR is variable as reported in various studies. Wisconsin study, which was the hallmark study of retinopathy, reported the prevalence of diabetic retinopathy in people diagnosed before the age of 30 to be 70% and 97.5% in patients with diabetes for less than 5 and 15 years or more duration respectively. So proliferative diabetic retinopathy is one of the leading cause of blindness as previously discussed. And for vision threatening retinopathy, there are limited treatment options. Laser therapy or panretinal photocoagulation is effective at preventing further visual deterioration if the patient is detected on time. Without treatment, most of the patients may become blind in 5 to 10 years. It is therefore important to identify signs of retinopathy early, so steps could be taken to slow the progression or treat it early. Thus, the goal of retinopathy screening is timely detection of retinopathy that would, without intervention, cause vision loss. So, as we all know, the DR is a microvascular complication and is...
I think you are exceeding the time, Dr. Nikita.
I would like to conclude, diabetic retinopathy from type 1 diabetes has been reported to have a more advanced nature with prevalence of PDR reaching up to 30%, hence becoming one of the leading cause of blindness. For vision-threatening retinopathy, limited options are available. Therefore, it is important to diagnose it in time and so that we can start the treatment and even the medication modification early.